Hey everyone, this is Tony Day with Tony Responds with an answer to a question from our Patreon community. This one's from Todd, and he's asking for some basic advice and general advice for using Sony products. He mentions possibly getting an FX3, and he also is asking for some advice on lenses, cinema lenses in particular, zooms and primes. He's also asking about best practices. And also how to color grade and use the footage in post. So let's take each one of these one at a time. The first I'm going to talk about is lenses. And I want to first say that there is no such thing as best lenses for really any camera. That's just a fact. There is no such thing as best. So I can't tell you what the best is. And I also cannot tell you what the best focal lengths are. There are tons of videos that tell you, oh, you need to own this lens, you must have this lens, this is the best 35 millimeter, that kind of thing. And really, it's nonsense, okay? There is a whole host of people who believe that having lenses that have tons of character, which are defects in the lens, usually looks better than having perfected lenses. So it's even in that front, you can't mathematically prove which one would be the best over something else. So it's not something I can answer in that kind of way. The only thing I can tell you really about this to give you some help is that it's very normal to not really know what to get. And the only way that you're going to figure that out is for you to test many different lenses from different brands and figure out what works best for you. I can tell you all day that, let's say, a 135 millimeter on large format looks best for headshots, but there's a ton of people who would disagree and say that a normal field of view looks better, something like a 50 millimeter or a 55 millimeter. So it really does depend when you're talking about cinema, especially. It depends on the kind of product you're making and how you see things. Because how you see things are going to be unique, and what tells the story you want to tell. You know, one lens might do it and another lens might not do it. No matter how much other people tell you, it's the better lens. Generally speaking, when any director of photography is going to go and do a shoot, especially if it's something that's in cinema, you need to cater the lenses and the filters, especially with what you're going to be making. There will be a huge difference between what you use for a action, like a modern action movie, compared to something that is supposed to be a period piece from, let's say, the 1700s. One is going to probably ask for more of a vintage-y feel, and the other one more of a modern feel. So that's what you have to do. You really need to figure out what's going to work best for the kind of thing that you're making. As far as general advice, though, I would say that if you want to really use Sony cameras and the technology that's in them to their best, I would say look at getting some less expensive photography lenses that have autofocus, because they're fantastic. I use the Sigma 24-70 f/2.8 all the time, and it is a great lens. It's the 24-70 f/2.8 Sigma DGDN. With large format, 24-70 is going to cover all the necessary focal lengths I think you'll need. You might want to go as far as to go all the way out to 100 and get a 24-105 f/4 if you can have the slower f-stop. I'll say that I've used f/4 lenses for a long time with Super 35 and more recently with larger format, and the separation, background separation, still looks great, especially on large format. F2.8 gives at you that little bit more, and I'd say about an F2 to F2.8 f-stop is about as blurry as I generally want to see the background, because with large format, you get very, very thin depth of field when you start using those much wider f-stops. I have also an 85 f1.4 DGDN Sigma that I use as well. And that is for generally headshots. Okay, that's a dedicated headshot lens. That's all it does. And I usually use between f1.8 and f4 with that lens. So the second part of the question has to do with best practices with a camera. And really, this is with any camera. Sony cameras, like any, you need to know how to shoot with them. And with the log profiles, if you're going to get an FX3, you need to know how to expose for the different log profiles to get what you want, and also be able to work with them in post to get the results that you want. That's really it. And there's no camera that is unique in this. Every single camera that you might want to use requires you to study it and really understand how it works before using it, especially on a paid shoot. Really know the limitations. If you rely on autofocus as a solo shooter, know when you can use it and when you can't. Know how to toggle it on and off easily, how to use the different settings, what they all mean, all of those different things. Make sure that you turn in-body image stabilization off when you put the camera on a tripod. That's something that I have seen where people forget, and then they leave IBIS on and you can see that the sensor is basically fighting the movement of a camera if they've got it on a tripod and they're trying to follow action and things like that, and it can look really bad. So definitely make sure you do that. And as far as color profiles, honestly, if you're shooting with an FX3, S-Log3 and S-Gamut or S-Gamut 3 Cine, any of those are going to be great. If you manually grade, which I don't recommend, S-Gamut 3 Cine is going to be easier to grade than S-Gamut 3. And if you wanted to know why I'm picking S-Log3 over S-Log2, I think so far what I've seen with the FX3, and I've used footage from it, S-Log3 looks great. And it has just a little bit more room to add dynamic range, where S-Log2 tends to have a little bit less. I think in most situations, you're probably not going to really notice much of a difference between the two, but S-Log3, I think, is a little bit better. For the last part of the question, which is color grading and using it in post, what I recommend is for color grading, use DaVinci Resolve and use color management. I would recommend that with any camera that you've got, because you will, if you use color management, you will get used to how the tools work, and the tools will work exactly the same way regardless of what camera you use. You will not have to adapt to other cameras, and you can choose whatever color space you like to work in. If you like working in Arilog C, you can work in Arilog C. If you like using the new DaVinci Wide Gamut, you can do that. So it's fully customizable, which is fantastic. I think it works great, because you can also output you can output it to whatever display you're grading to, and then you can change that output to whatever your deliverable is going to be. If you have an sRGB monitor, for example, you can output to sRGB, and then when it comes time for delivery, you just change to Rec 709, Gamma 2.4, and you can deliver to that. You can do the same thing with an HDR render. If you want to make let's say it's an HLG or any other HDR kind of render, you can change the output. There's a little bit more that you have to do to prepare for that, but you can do it, and it does not require you going back and having to regrade everything from scratch. So because of that, that is why I really think that color management is the way to go with most material that you're going to have. So that's really it, and I do hope that that was helpful for you. If you do have any more questions, please do not hesitate to ask in the comments section below. And I want to extend a thank you to all of the members of the Patreon community. Without you, this kind of program would not be possible. And I look forward to speaking to you all again next time.